An Epicurean is, to us, a foodie, a wine buff, or a gourmet. But the word has an ancient philosophical provenance and a radical edge. Recovering something of its lost meaning involves looking afresh at the burning issues of the 21st century, the perennial search for happiness, and the urgent challenge of sustainability. Epicurus, a Hellenistic philosopher active in the 3rd century BC, withdrew from society with his followers to a garden beyond Athens. There he taught the importance of living with nature, taming one's desires, and cultivating a certain joy in pure existence. Epicurus was remarkably prescient. Only by freeing ourselves from the incessant urging of desire, he counseled, will we lay the foundations of our own happiness. He saw the gelding of runaway desire and the search for happiness as one and the same thing. The other key Epicurean principle was liberation from superstition. The Epicureans pictured the cosmos in terms of atoms and void. At the point of death, they insisted, we simply dissolve into our constituent parts. There is no post-mortem life for the soul, no afterlife. No reward or punishment awaits us. The ancient argument for atheism, conventionally attributed to Epicurus, has lost none of its force in the past 23 centuries. It runs like this. If God wants to prevent evil but can't, then he is not omnipotent. If he is able to prevent evil but doesn't want to, then he is malevolent. If he is willing and able to prevent evil, then why does evil exist? If he is neither willing nor able to prevent evil, then why call him God? The key to living happily once superstition has been banished, Epicurus believed, was keeping things simple. Better to learn how to take pleasure in simple things than to be forever chasing pleasure. Epicurus was no Epicurean in the sense that we understand the term. He was certainly not a foodie. Plain dishes, he believed, offer the same pleasure as a luxurious table. What was on the menu at the garden of Epicurus? Weak wine, bread, water, a pot of cheese, and friendship. The Roman philosopher-statesman Cicero, though broadly hostile to Epicureanism, observed that the school's leader genuinely lived through filial love. In other words, he practiced what he preached. Friendship goes dancing around the world, Epicurus rhapsodized, announcing to all of us to wake up to happiness. While other philosophers of the period practiced an indifference towards grief, even at the loss of a child, Epicurus felt this attempt to insulate ourselves from sorrow with a stoic steeliness of heart was ultimately inhuman. Here are three words from ancient Greek. Eudaimonism, virtuous happiness or personal flourishing. Hedon, pleasure. Ataraxia, freedom from anxiety. Epicurus puts them together in a unique way to create a rational, virtuous philosophy of pleasure. He urged the pursuit of what might be called sober pleasures. To pursue excessive or unnatural pleasure was to invite the pain of want. He may, in the technical sense, have been a hedonist, but he was no voluptuary. The Garden of Epicurus was the first philosophical school to admit women on principle, rather than as an exception. On the other hand, Epicurus, like most ancient philosophers, was deeply suspicious of passionate love and its power to unseat reason. The philosophy of Epicurus survives only in fragments. We have the philosopher's letters to disciples, quotations from other philosophers, a didactic poem from the 1st century BC Roman poet Lucretius titled On the Nature of Things, and a 3rd century biography replete with letters from the philosopher to his disciples. In this threadbare state, the Epicurean tradition recalls Yeats' aged man, a tattered coat upon a stick. And yet the philosophy hammered out by this tattered ancient has a cheering prescience. Our contemporary debates about climate change and environmental degradation bring it into sharp and fresh focus. Epicurus taught his followers how to be happy without God, and how to be happy with less. The poet Lucretius, for his part, diagnosed the human frailty that feeds the fires of rampant consumerism. That thing we want and can't get seems, of all things, the most desirable, he wrote. But once we have it, we must have something else. These lines were penned at the apogee of paganism, but they are perfectly relevant in the age of the plasma screen. Time and again, Epicurus and his followers return to the theme of limits. One must regard wealth beyond what is natural, he said, as of no more use than water to a container that is full to overflowing. The sentiment is prophetic. In their mid-2012 book, How Much is Enough? Money and the Good Life, British economists Robert and Edward Skidelsky argue against a disease by the name insatiability, which they define as that psychological disposition that prevents us as individuals and as societies from saying enough is enough. Epicurus was the first philosopher in the Western tradition to diagnose the disease of insatiability. Nothing is enough, he wrote, for the man to whom enough is too little. And he was the first to propose a cure. The Epicurean message teaches us to be content with what satisfies our fundamental needs, while renouncing what is superfluous. If translated into contemporary terms, it would compel us to temper our mania for consumption of more cars, electrical goods, clothes, and sheer stuff. If practiced en masse, it would remake our world not so much in the name of social revolution as personal happiness. A revitalized contemporary Epicureanism is the kind of personal ethic that would accompany a low-growth economy. The idea of prosperity without growth was first articulated in the 19th century by John Stuart Mill, who conceived of an enlightened stationary state towards which advanced capitalism would inevitably move. For the best state for human nature is that in which, while no one is poor, no one desires to be richer, nor has any reason to fear being thrust back by the efforts of others to push themselves forward. The deep historical taproot of this line of radical thinking is Epicurus and his ethic of living within nature's limits. The notion of natural limits has a metaphorical rather than a literal force. It conveys the ideal of harmony with nature rather than sovereignty over her. For the Epicureans and for their great poet Lucretius, the earth was a vibrant biological entity. Epicurus was reputed to have written 300 books, including a 37-part magnum opus titled On Nature, some fragments of which survive. In time, his philosophy became a popular creed, a dogma, a rival to Christianity. It was said to have taken Italy by storm in the 1st century AD. Unlike the philosophical schools fathered by Plato and Aristotle, which were restricted to an intellectual elite, the Epicureans thought of their therapy as practical, accessible, democratic. Think of it as a form of mindfulness, rather like Buddhism, which also provides the tools to distance oneself from desire. Detachment in the Buddhist and Taoist tradition is a virtue. As an old Chinese proverb puts it, absence of desire generates strength. And yet Epicurus doesn't ask us to eliminate our desires. He asks us to tame them, for rampant desire easily becomes sickness, a source of suffering. A contemporary retrofitted Epicureanism is perfectly compatible with soft connoisseurship, enjoying good food, especially good produce and good wine, enjoying it deeply while not allowing gastronomic obsessions to distract from that other art of the table, conversation. The Roman Stoic Seneca counseled a friend, "Live as if Epicurus were watching you." Seneca's injunction bears comparison with the concept of living in Christ, and yet in the figure of Epicurus, there is no hint of Christian tristesse or pathos. He is not there to shepherd you towards the next world, but to help you live wisely and well in this one. The therapeutic philosophies of the Hellenistic age took the form of spiritual practices or meditative exercises. Their purpose was the recollection of past joys and the appreciation of deep pleasure taken in the moment. The desired result was serenity and a disposition towards happiness, though we might call it cool. The respected French philosopher Pierre Hadot, an expert in the thought of the Hellenistic period, distilled the Epicurean therapy to its essence. We should live in profound gratitude towards nature and life, which constantly offer us pleasure and joy. The philosophy of the garden was not conceived with a social purpose in mind, but it has acquired one. A rational hedonism that argues against the aggressive pursuit of desire, against the excesses of luxury, wealth, and power. This is a hedonistic philosophy of life with benign social and ecological consequences. It speaks not only to our concerns about personal happiness, it addresses our anxieties about human survival.